right?
Yes.
You're just going to fill it in based on the words. So you have all the questions. The only one down, question 7, we might not be able to get to. So if anything, just skip it, you'll be fine without it. Don't worry. That's all. If you anyone have any questions how to fill this out? No? Okay, we're good.
Alright, so good afternoon everyone. We are team 1 and we're going to be going over the Kumulipo, which is the creation story of Hawaii. So let's, before we start going over the Kumulipo, let's go over how Hawaii was founded. So first, 1500 years ago, Polynesians arrived to Hawaii using just the stars. And if you're further interested in this, there is a documentary called Kantiki, where a Norwegian explorer actually proves how this happened. James Cook was the first European contact, and he actually, when he came, he had pale skin and white sails, and he came during December, which is the month where Hawaiians celebrate the god of Lono. And when they saw James Cook, they thought he was the god, so they took him and they recited the chant, the Kumulipo chant, to him, and he was the first person who brought back the Kumulipo chant back to Europe. After the European was. We had European contact, the Kamehameha dynasty was united, and then after that, in 1898, the U.S. was annexed by the U.S. The Kumulipo was created over many nights. It wasn't just created one day, and since there was no written language, it was passed down from orally from generation to generation. And then in 1889, King Kalakaua first rewrote it and transcribed it in the Hawaiian language, and then in 1897, when Queen Liliuokalani was in house arrest, she retranslated that to English. So the Kumulipo, it translates to teacher of darkness because it's going over how the universe was created, and it's divided into 16 wands, which also synonymous to chapters, basically. So the first 7 are under Po, which is darkness, or also known as age of spirit, and each watch is a new birth of animals. The last 9 are the owl, which is the arrival of light and gods. Light gods.
As Lauren said, the Kumulipo has a really big emphasis on a transition from darkness into light and from nothing into something. The very first beings that were born out of this deep darkness were Kumulipo and Puele. All of them come in pairs of male and female, so Kumulipo was the male and Puele was the female, and their names meant the essence of darkness and darkness itself. They created all the creatures that live in darkness, so animals you find at the very bottom sea where there is no sunlight, and eventually they gave birth to another couple, Pauliuli and Kuvehiveki, which were slightly lighter, because with every generation there was more and more light, so these beings created creatures that didn't live in such darkness, but there still wasn't really any light. Yeah. Out of that came Pu'alele and Pohaha. This is where we see their names becoming different. Pohaha's name translates to coming into dawn. So now you see a little more light. And they had a huge egg that, when it hatched, produced the thousands and thousands of birds that were native to the world. Out of them came Poponopono and Palako Vehi, created creatures of near darkness. So at this point, you can come to animals that live on land, but also in places where there isn't as much light as there is now. And the last couple would be Pokilolo and Poneaaku, whose names both mean night ending. And after them came these two animals. They're the only two animals that have names in the Hawaiian creation myth. They're the rat and the pig, Pilo and Kamapua. The reason that they might have names is because, as we know, the pig is really important to Hawaiian culture. It was their main source of food still today. If you go to Hawaii, you can have roasted pig a lot. And the rat was actually not native to Hawaii. It was brought there by the Polynesians. And there you almost see a sort of syncretic faith because they've woven in these aspects that they brought to Hawaii into their oral culture.
So in the Hawaiian religion, in Kumulipo, there's the 4 major gods, who are also known as Akua. So the first one is Kanai, which is the god of procreation, and symbolizes a lot of like flower station, trees, things like that. And this is the highest of all the gods, so this is the main one that they would worship. And it was also known as the ancestor of all chiefs and commoners. So Kanai is kind of like the head of where all the people came from. and it was known as like the creator and giver of life. And then Kana had a counterpart, which is Kanaloa, which is the god of the underworld, the ocean, and is known as the teacher of magic. So these two pictures kind of show something similar to what Lisa was saying, like the system of dichotomies, the opposites. So we have the underworld, and then we have kind of like everything above it. Kanaloa is symbolized by an octopus, and it was known to be long-distance voyagers. So it was kind of the big guiding force of all like travel that occurred with the Polynesians. It was also known as like a leader of spirits, kind of like spit out by the other gods to be a counterpart for Kana. And then there's Ku, which is the god of strength, war, and healing. And it's kind of considered like the snatcher of the land. It kind of strengthened all of the land, everything going on there. And it was known to provide focus, energy, and motivation. And then human sacrifices were something that they did for Ku. This was the only god that they really had to perform this for. So human sacrifice rituals were performed just for Ku. So it's kind of like a significant thing there. And then Lono was the god of cultivated foods and peace. And then going back to what Lauren said before about James Cook, how he came during the month of December, that's when the Hawaiians celebrate the festival of Makahiki, which is celebrated from either October or November until about February or March. And this festival was to celebrate fertility, agriculture, and rainfall. And then specifically the god of Lono, which was like the provider of rain, provider of agriculture, so basically like provider of everything needed to produce and continue making life.
So what's the creation and origin story of these gods then? The gods also came from probably similar to all the creatures that Lisa had mentioned. And we can see a bit of a family tree, which we will explain in depth. But to start, we have the four major gods, Kane, Ku, Lono, and Kanaloa. Kane was Inpo, and he somehow sensed that he was different and that he had a consciousness. So he pulled himself out. Then Lono and Ku were able to also sense Kane's presence, so they pulled themselves out. So then Kane creates light in order to push back Po and to begin a new era. Lono brings sound to the universe, and Ku brings substance. So there we have the things that would then make up the world and make up the early divisions of people. You notice Kanaloa isn't really part of that story. He's not in some of the older written translations of things that we've found. Kanaloa is kind of considered to be another syncretic addition to the faith, but he isn't in this version of the creation of the gods, but in other versions we find that he was created as a like a counter to Kane.
And then Wakea and then Ho Lani had a son.
So the first son that they had was named Halawa, but it was stillborn, so they buried him into the ground, and then from that grew the taro plant, also known as palo. And then that is kind of known as like where all the plants came from, and that is also considered like the star overall people developed from. So the kalo plant symbolizes like connection to the past, and it's highly worshipped as one of the most important agriculture products of Hawaii, because that's where all their food is said to come from. And then they had a second son, which was again named Halawa, and that's considered the first person. So the first son was the stillborn that got buried, and then that symbolizes all the agriculture beginnings, and then the next son, also again named Halawa, was kind of like the start of all the people.
So we have two art pieces that we were going to show you, and we can't, so I'm just going to show you here the best. This is what Miles wants to talk about.
The board?
It's
just frozen?
Yeah.
No.
So this is my depiction of Wakea and Papa. So so you could see it kind of looks like Papa is like sitting up, kind of getting up from laying down. I based that off, so there's this island, there's this Polynesian island that looks like a woman like laying on her backside. It's called Hawaiian. And I kind of wanted to base that off that, so it looks like she's built into a mountain getting up. So there's not a lot of depictions of these two online, but the ones that I found one by a Hawaiian artist that I kind of took the most inspiration from, where they kind of like, Wakea was this guy, and Papa like was built into the earth, so I kind of based off that. And finally, you can see she's wearing like a red flower crown. And so when I was looking for pictures of Papa, a lot of the depictions had like red or red flowers, I noticed, so I wanted to include that somehow, so I gave her a red flower.
So this is the second art piece I did. I'm sorry, it's small, probably easier for you to see the board. So here we have the night sky at daytime. This is Wakea, and this is Ho'okulani, and this is their stillborn, Kalo. You can see him growing from the ground into a taro plant. So there's not a lot of depictions of this portion of the stories. It's mainly if you search it up, you'll see a taro plant. So this is honestly taken from what I imagined the story shape itself would look like, but you can see the different contractions of the different sides and there's still more.
So one important thing that we really want to highlight in these myths is this system of dichotomies. You have earth and sky is really strong, the transition from dark to light or nothingness to substance. And then we also want to point out the distinction between male and female is always very strong and it's very clear, but the distinction between man and God isn't as clear. We talked about those couples. In some depictions, they're gods, in some depictions, they're not. But you always have male and female. In the Hawaiian language, you don't have gender, like, word endings or names necessarily. So you have to specify after. You would say, you know, the name as a man or the name as a woman. And in every first instance of using a name in the Mulipo, they show that. So now we have a quick animation that hopefully will work that will show the beginning of the Mulipo.
You don't even necessarily need volume.
Okay.
Oh, it has the O, oh, yeah, okay.
You gotta switch to the computer so you don't need to switch it.
Sorry.
No, it's I said it.
So
you'll hear like the actual
human
like chanting.
Oh, yeah, we got Willie Vella. kakaondu. Oge oi ka uli lore kane. Oge oi kuka iaka kala. E o ma la ma la mai ka ma la. Oge o ma ka ni ka po. Oga vale vale ho kumu honua i. Oge kumu o ka ni po i li po ai. Oge kumu o ka po i po ai. Oga li po li po, oga li po li po. Oga li po ka la, oga li po ka po po vale ho i. Hana kapo, hana kumuli poi kapo he kani, hana po elei kapo he mane, hana ka ukuko akwa, hana kana he akwa akwa puka.
So right there, that was symbolizing like the birth of their first child, Loa, and then being planted in the ground and the tower plant growing.
Hana ke ko e nuhe eli ho opu honua, hana kana he ko e puka, hana ka pea ka pea pea kana.
Can you spell all of them?
I'll just read out the answers. Yeah.
Are you going to take a picture of it for me?
Okay, we'll do that. Okay. So you have any other questions that I didn't talk about?
And cut.